So what does the participant have to do in this task? You see that in the introduction explained as before. The participant has to detect two targets in this very rapid stream of letters. And the first target that the participant has to report is the white letter. So all letters are black, except one. One letter is white, and the participant has to say what letter that is. So if there's like a white T, then the participant has to say, okay, I saw a T. And the second task that the participant has to do is indicate whether he or she saw an X. So there are two targets, right? The white letter and the X, which can be either present or not. Now, this white letter is called the T1, so it's the first target that the participant has to detect. And the X is called the T2, so it's the second letter that the participant has to detect. So, and the main thing that makes this experiment kind of difficult to implement is that we have that it's very dynamic, right? It's not like a single static screen that the participant sees, but it is really this very rapid presentation of letters that we have to program using Python. And that's what it makes this experiment kind of difficult to make. But we can make it. You will see that in 1.5 hours we will be able to make it. Okay, so we're going to start with step one, which is starting OpenSesame and installing it. Everyone has OpenSesame installed, right? You're all good? Good. Okay, then we come to step two, and it says choose the template, the font, and the color. So we're going to start basically by setting up our experiment. Now, and like in the last tutorial, we're going to start with this extended template that already gives us kind of the basic blocks of our experiment, right? It already has kind of the structure that most cognitive experiments have. So once you start OpenSesame in the Get Started thing, you're going to click on the extended template, right? And then we open up the extended template. Okay, so and then you see this is just layers last week, right? You see on the left side of the screen, you see that the experiment already has the basic structure of the experiment that we want to create. Starting with the practice loop, right? If we give the participant some time for practice, followed by an experiment loop. So it's already a good start. Then what we want to do is we want to change the font and the colors. And this is important because we're going to have black letters and white letters. So we don't need the black background because black letters on a black background are invisible, of course, right? So we want to change the background color to gray. So what we're going to do is click on what is called the General tab. So just the thing that you open when you click on this top level item here. And then what you see is this screen. The screen that already showed, that allows you to kind of specify the main properties of your experiment, right? The resolution of the screen, the foreground color, background color, the default font, etc. And the only thing that we're basically going to do is change the background color, which is now black, and we change it to gray. And we're going to change the font, because by default the font is 18 pixels, which is not very big, right? It will be like a tiny letter in the middle of the screen. And we're going to change it to 32, which is a little bit bigger, so that the participant can actually see the letters that are presented. Okay, so that's good. So those are the only two things that we're going to change here. But of course you can change different things, right? If you need to do so for your experiment. Now, step three is already a little bit complicated because this experiment needs counterbalancing. Now, who here knows what counterbalancing is? Or probably more, who dares to say out loud what counterbalancing is? What is it?
Counterbalance
has to be across
participants,
so you
control the item specifically.
Exactly. Yes, that's a very psycholinguistic explanation of counterbalancing, but it is correct in principle. So counterbalancing is just like if you have, for example, something that you change during your experiment that is a little bit different for you between participants, then you say, okay, we make sure that one half of the participants is exposed to one situation, and the other half of the participants is exposed to the other situation. And the classical example of it, and that's also the example here, is order. Say that we have two conditions that we vary between blocks. We start with a control condition, a block of control conditions, and then a block of experimental conditions, then we don't always want to start with a block of control trials and then experimental trials, right? So we're going to counterbalance that so that half the participants start with the experimental trials and half the participants start with the control trials. And that is counterbalancing. And counterbalancing comes in many, many different flavors, right? This is basically the simplest flavor of counterbalancing that you have, but you have much more complicated arrangements, especially in psycholinguistics, with counterbalance the help of their experiments. Okay, so, and I think now that we're here, I should probably explain you a little bit better what the experiment is, because when I tried the first time, I was still a little bit thrown off by the whole situation with the room reservation. So we're going to make a better explanation. I will give you a better explanation of the experiment. Like this, let's zoom in so that you really see it, right? So everyone can see it. So these letters are presented sequentially, right? So not like this, all at the same time on the screen, but one after the other. T, A, H, D, D, Y, X. And what the participant has to do is two things. First, identify the white letter, which is the T, right? So after the participant sees this, the participant types, okay, I saw the T. And the second thing that the participant has to do is say whether one of the letters was an X or not. In this case, there is an X. So the participant says, yes, I saw an X. That is the experimental condition, because here we have T1, the white letter, and T2, the X. We also have a control condition in which the participant only says whether there was an X, but does not indicate whether what the identity of the white letter was. And the logic is that if the participant has to identify what the white letter was, then the participant has to process the white letter, and it causes this attentional blink that makes it difficult to identify the X when it comes later. If the participant does not have to identify the white letter, then we don't have any attentional blink, and the participant usually doesn't have any trouble identifying whether there was an X or not. Is the logic of that experiment of the experiment clear? So the stimuli are the same in the control and the experimental condition. The only difference is the instruction to the participant, namely whether the participant has to identify the white letter or not. The white letter is always there, but in the control condition, the participant doesn't have to identify it. So that's the difference between the experimental and the control condition. And we're going to counterbalance the order of these two conditions. So how are we going to do that? Well, what we're going to do is we're going to dive right into using Python. And using Python is done with this this little Python icon, right? This little blue yellow thing. And we're going to drag that to the top of the experiment. Okay. I'll throw away the new sketchpad because it was just for explanation. So here we have a little script. And I'm going to call that script counterbalance. Right, because you always need to give a good name to your script, because otherwise you're going to forget what it does. It's important that you give it a good name. Now, and then we have to explain a little bit how Python scripting works. And this is quite simple, so I think you will be able to follow. In OpenSesame, you have variables, right? You have experimental variables. Things like your independent variables that you define in your script, things like your subject number, things like the resolution of your screen, etc. All those things are experimental variables. If you want to access those in an inline script, what you do is you type var to indicate that it's an experimental variable, dot, and then the name of the variable. And then you can make use of the fact that, for example, OpenSesame has a variable that's called subject number, which has the subject number, right? If you start the experiment, you indicate which subject number you use, and this is stored as var.subject. What is also quite useful is that OpenSesame also has a variable called subject parity, Yes, these are online. They're online, you will find a list of all the experimental variables that you can use. all the experimental variables that always exist. Of course, you can also define your own experimental variables in your experiment, right? But subject parity is one of those experimental variables that always exists. So I will just zoom in a little bit, unless you can see it. So make it nice and big. Okay, there we go. Now, and parity is just kind of, it's just one of these complicated English words that means whether something is even or not, right? So the number 0, 2, 4, 6 are even. They are, what do you say that in French? Even and odd? What's the
In pair.
Okay, so even, I imagine, is pair. In pair is odd. Okay. So, what we can say, if we want to do, so say that we want to, for all the even participants, so if the subject parity is even, so that is participant 0, participant 2, participant 4, etc., we want to start. Condition 1 is the experimental condition, and var condition 2 is the control condition. Else, we do it the other way around. Control. Now, this script is basically so easy that you can almost read it as though it is just actual language, right? So what it says was, if the subject parity is even, so for all even participants, the first condition is the experimental condition, the second condition is the control condition. Else, so for all uneven participants, all participants, the first condition is the control condition, and the second condition is the experimental condition. Now, in Python, you see that here we use two equal signs, and here we use only one. The difference between these two is basically if we use two equal signs, then we're asking a question. We're asking if is subject parity equal to even. If we use only one equal sign, it's called an assignment. So here we're asking if subject parity is equal to even. And here we're assigning. Here we're making sure that condition one is experimental. Is that distinction clear? Right? It's already kind of obvious from an if, right? Before the subject here. Okay, but basically this is counterbalancing, right? It's not that difficult. It's 6 lines. I think it's manageable. Right. So this was step three, and as the tutorial says, this script says the following: all even numbered subjects start with the experimental condition. All odd subjects start with the control. Of course, we have to program our experiment so that these two variables are actually used, right? We're going to do that later. That doesn't automatically happen. We have to make sure that happens. Okay. Step 4. Now we're going to move on to step 4. And in step 4, we're going to define the experimental variables that are varied between boxes. Yes. And again, we're going to explain the structure that we see here to make sure that we all understand what the structure of the experiment is. Because that's kind of complicated. I think one of the most complicated things about OpenSesame is kind of working with this structure that you see and understanding what the hierarchy of the structure means. So we have at the bottom, we have the trial sequence, which corresponds to a single trial. Huh? That's also what the name says, corresponds to a single trial. And a single trial would be this one stream of letters that would correspond to one single trial. Then one level up, we have the block loop, which corresponds to one block of trials, right? So multiple trials that are executed in a row. One level above that, we have the block sequence, which also corresponds to one block of trials, but it adds a little bit, namely, it resets the feedback at the start of the block and presents participant feedback after the block, right? So in this experiment, basically, after each block of trials, or after, I don't know how many blocks of trials we have in the block, but say after every 20 trials, we tell the participant how well he or she was doing, which is a nice thing, I think. It's a nice thing to do to the participant. Okay, and then one level up, we have the practice loop and the experimental loop, and they repeat, they consist of multiple blocks. Now you also see that if I click here, for example, on block sequence, you see that I select two things, right? I select this block sequence and I select this block sequence. That's because they are the same thing. They are just the exact same item. So we use the same block sequence during the practice trials and during the experimental trials. So that in OpenSesame that is generally true. If you have one item, you can reuse it at multiple points in your experiment. Okay, is the structure of the experiment kind of clear to everyone? It's a bit complicated. That takes a little bit of getting used to understand. So what we're going to do is we're going to click on the practice loop, and this is where we are going to define our counterbalancing initially. And what we're going to do, basically, if you see it visually in figure 5, it's very quite easy. We're going to say, okay, we have two practice blocks. So I put the cycle here on 2, and you will see that I suddenly have two cycles. Meaning that log sequence is called 2 times. Well, I add the S. I'll just type it and then I'll explain what we're doing. Condition, I add a variable. First one, condition 1. Condition 2. And I move it to sequential. Okay. So what are we doing here? This seems kind of complicated maybe, but it's not really. So what's happening here? The fact that the number of cycles is set to 2 means that we're going to call log sequence 2 times during the practice loop, meaning that the practice loop, that the practice session, sorry, practice phase consists of 2 blocks. Simple as that. We have 2 variables that we define, practice, which we set to yes, so that we know that these are practice blocks, right? So during the analysis, we can remove them. And a variable called condition, which first starts with condition 1 and then condition 2. Now, you remember those square brackets maybe from last week? Basically, what it means is that the first, where it says between square brackets condition 1, is going to get the value of the variable condition 1. Right? And where it says condition 2 is going to get the value of the variable condition 2. Now, if we go back to a counterbalancing script, you see that that this depends. This is basically how we implement counterbalancing. If this for all even subjects, the variable condition 1 will be experimental, and condition 2 will be controlled. Which means here that for all even participants, we will start with the experimental trials, followed by the control trials. And for the old participants, it will be the other way around, right? So that is the logic. And then I change the order from random to sequential, because if I leave it at random, then it will just randomize this, and our whole counterbalancing thing will be messed up, right? Because it will not have any, the order will be randomized. So that is basically how we're going to implement counterbalancing in the practice loop. Now, in the experimental loop, we're going to do the same thing. So we're going to click on the experimental loop. We're going to put the cycles again to 2. Now practice is no, because this is the experimental session, right? These are not long practice trials. We don't want to remove these during analysis. Add variable, condition. Condition 1, condition 2. Alright, and I change the order to sequential. It's kind of easy to forget, but if you forget it, then the counterbalancing will not. And I'm also going to save my experiment so that if anything goes wrong, I still have it. Okay, yes, that's it. So basically, we do the same trick for the practice loop and the experimental loop. Because there is not any real difference between the practice session of the practice phase of the experiment and the experimental phase. The main difference is that we're not going to analyze the practice trials, but we are going to analyze the experimental trials. Does anyone have questions about this, about what we've been doing here? No?
Can
No? Just kind of clear?
We have also to specify something called subject parity.
No, good point. So the question was whether we have to specify subject parity, and we don't. What happens is that OpenSesame, when you start the experiment, asks you for a subject number.
Oh, I see. So
and it will automatically set the subject parity.
Okay, so even if something already specified.
When you start, it's one of these variables that always exists.
Okay.
So if you specify a subject number 0, 2, 4, etc., subject parity will have the value even. If you specify an odd number, it will have the value. So they will automatically have. And a list of all the variables that are automatically available to you in OpenSesame is available on the documentation site. So you can see it there. Okay. So, now we're going to move on to step 5, which is easy. We're going to do the instruction. But we have to create two types of instructions. Okay. Yes. So, what we want to do is basically present a short instruction screen before before every walk, because the instruction is a little bit different between walks, right? Last week we started with an instruction screen all the way at the top. But now we need to present a different kind of instruction before every block, because the instruction is different. So what we're going to do is we're going to drag two sketch pads, like these little things, up into the block sequence, to the top, like this. If you drag it on top of the block sequence, you see that it will be there will be kind of like a square around it. If I then drop, it will ask whether I want to insert the new thing in the block sequence or after it. And what I want to do is in, right? So if I do that, the new sketchpad will be in the block sequence. I drag another one here. So basically, if I would have selected after block sequence, so if I draw a sketchpad on it and I say insert after block sequence, you see that it will come after it. Right? So here in the new sketchpad. So that's not what we want. We want to drop it in. Okay, then we have two instruction screens. It's good to give it a nice name, right? So it's instructions experimental. Instructions control. And then we give it some useful give it some useful content, right? So we have to tell the participant what to do. So we can select the little text line element to draw the text. We click in center, we've already done this last week, right, I think. And then you can add whatever kind of text you want. So the instructions, who remembers what the participant had to do in this experiment? Maybe a bit, probably you've forgotten already.
To detect an X.
To detect an X, indeed, that was it.
And there was like two differences between one, one condition and the other, also to remind, to detect. To identify the white
line. Exactly. So depending in the experimental trials, in the experimental block, sorry, the experimental condition, the participant has to report the identity of the white letter. I'll just type it really quickly like this. Obviously, it's always important to make a nice, good-looking instruction screen that is very clear to the participant, right? Otherwise, the participant is not going to understand what the task is. And report whether an X was present. Press any key to begin. Oh, maybe instructions well. Okay. Oh, then we have a nice instruction screen. Okay. So that is the so those are the instructions for the experimental condition. What are the instructions for the control condition?
Just report whether an X.
Report whether an X was present. Exactly. So I'll just basically copy this text up. And then in the control condition, I'll click on the control condition, select the text tool up. And then I just remove the report the identity of the white letter. Okay, report with our next experiment. Now you see that the duration of the sketchpad is key press, which means that the sketchpad will be visible on the screen until the participant presses the key. Right? So, which is fine. That's the default duration. Now, if I now click on the block sequence, you see that we start with the experimental instructions, we then have control instructions, we then reset feedback, which just means that we basically clear all the feedback information that the experiment has, so that we at the end of the block loop we will only present feedback about that block, right? So that we don't have like a continuously accumulating feedback. And we obviously run the block of trials. So what is wrong with this sequence?
We don't want to show both instructions each time.
Obviously. So how are we going to fix that?
Change the run.
Change the run. To condition one or condition two, but not only, right? Because that's it's just condition one is not by itself it's not a thing that is true or false. It is just a string that says even or odd. So what we have to type here is what we have to do. We have to use the condition. We say run if condition between square brackets experimental, and here run if condition is controller. Right? So we use the condition variable, so we put it between square brackets, and we check whether it is experimental or control, and we use that to decide whether we're going to show the instructions for the experimental condition or for the control condition. Easy peasy. Okay, yes. Right. And now we're going to modify. That was the end of step 5. So we made the instructions, and we made sure that only the correct instructions are shown before each block. Do you have any questions about this, what we've been doing here? Does it sound logical, or does it sound kind of magical and weird? Yeah? No? It should be logical, huh? There's no magic here. Okay, what we're then going to do is a tiny step, step 6, namely modifying feedback. So if I click on the feedback, you will see it opens the feedback screen. I'll zoom in for you. And the feedback screen says your average response time was between square brackets AVG RT milliseconds. Your accuracy was X percent, was NET to continue. And here we again have the two of these variables that OpenSesame makes automatically, just like subject parent. You don't have to tell OpenSesame to keep track of the average RT. So the average response time or the accuracy, OpenSesame will automatically do that for you because it's so common that you want to know, right? Now, what is wrong with this feedback screen for our purpose is that in a typical attentional blink experiment, we're only interested in accuracy and not in response time because we give the participant all the time that he or she needs to answer. So I'll just double click on it and remove the response time thing. And maybe just I put an end of block method before it's up. Okay, that's fine. But I think in principle it is very good to give participants feedback after a block of trials, right? Because participants like to know how well they're doing the experiment. It's kind of motivating and makes it pleasant, or at least more pleasant than if you do not get any feedback. This is simple.
If I decide for not giving feedback, this would mean that the block sequence corresponds to a block loop, right? I do not have to have both.
No, you're right. So if you remove all the things that we now have in the block sequence, the instructions, the resetting of the feedback and the feedback, then you can just insert the block loop directly into the practice loop if you want to do that. But that is not what you want to do. Usually you will want to provide feedback. So that's why the default structure is like this. But you're right, if you don't want that, you can change the structure. Or phrased differently, a sequence with only one item in it is pointless. Then you can just remove the sequence altogether. Okay, yes. So we're going to move on to step 7. And this is where things get a little bit interesting again. We're going to define our experimental variables that are varied within a model. So we've already defined the experimental variables that have been varied between blocks, right? Because what experimental variable was that? What are we varying between blocks? Exactly, the condition, basically. The variable condition is manipulated between blocks. But we're also going to manipulate things within blocks. So if you manipulate something between blocks, it just means that you start first with one whole block in one condition, then a whole block in another condition. If you would vary condition within blocks, it would just mean that on every trial you can have a different condition. That's not what we want here. But we do want to vary things between blocks, within blocks, sorry. So we're going to click on block loop. And just to remind you where we are, so the trial sequence corresponds to a single trial. The block loop above it corresponds to a block of trials. And if we're going to add experimental variables here in this block loop, they will be varied within a block. They will be different for every trial. Now, basically, we have two experimental variables. We have the variable that is called lag, and we have the variable that is called T2 present. Now, the T2 present variable just indicates whether there is a target, whether there is an X or not. Right? Participant has to indicate whether there is an X or not. And we call the X the T2, so on some trials there is a T2, on some trials there is an X. Another variable, the variable lag, indicates the distance between the two targets, so the distance between the white letter and the X, if there is an X, right? If there is no X, then lag has no meaning. But if there is an X, then we specify the distance between the T1 and the T2. The T1 being the white letter, the T2 being the X. Now, what we're going to do, I'll just do it and then I'll explain it to you. I'm going to put this to 18 cycles. I add one variable lag. I add one variable T2. T2 present. And on half the trials, T2 present is yes. And on half the trials, T2 present is no. Now, on the trials where there is a T2, we have to also specify the lag. So the distance between the T1 and the T2. Lag at 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8. Now, why do we have a lag 0 to 8? Well, we do that because that's the way it was done in the original experiment. Obviously, you could choose also fewer lags for different lags. So, basically, if we take, for example, this trial, lag 0, T2 present, it would mean there is a white letter, and then the white letter is followed immediately by an X. If we take, for example, the trial where the T2 present is no, it means that there is a white letter and then there is no X. If we look here at T2 present yes, lag 2, it means there is a white letter, then there is some distractor, another distractor, and then there is an X. Right? Do you guys understand? Do you understand the coding of these conditions? It's maybe a little bit abstract if you don't know what the attentional link. Who here had heard of the attentional link before coming here? Yeah? Okay. So if you're not familiar with the attentional link, it may all sound a little bit esoteric, but it's really a very well-known experimental paradigm in cognitive psychology. Okay. Yes. So that's it. So we have 18 trials. Half the trials have a T2, half the trials don't. And on the trials that have a T2, we vary that. Okay. So, do you guys understand what's going on here? What we have defined here?
So, the empty ladder in a non-condition means that it's completely random and the appearance
no.
Because I know that, I mean, I understand the ladder variable, but I am a bit troubled by the empty cells.
Good question. Yeah. So basically, if there is no x, then there is also no distance between the white letter and the x. There is no, that doesn't have any meaning, right? It's not applicable. So we just leave it empty. Because, you know, what's the distance between a white letter and something that is not there? If there is no distance. So we just leave it empty. And only when there actually is an x, it makes sense to talk about the distance between the white letter and the x. And obviously, when I say distance, I don't mean distance in space. I mean distance in time, right? The distance of zero would mean white letter followed immediately by x. Distance of one would mean white letter, distractor, and then x.
You just said in some other problems like R, you have to specify what the variable
is. Yeah. Well, what would happen technically here is the variable length would still exist, but it would be an empty string. It would be a string of length zero. So it would be like empty text, but it would still have technically some kind of meaning, because just like in R, you need to, you know, it needs to have some kind of value. Okay, but it just looks empty to us. Okay, yes. Now, and this is where things are going to get interesting. We're going to define our trial sequence, and it will become a little bit trickier, guys. So if you have questions, let me know. So, I click on trial sequence. What we have so far is we have a sketch pad that shows a fixation dot, right? The sketch pad is the thing that shows visual stimuli, followed by a keyboard response that collects key press, followed by a logger that writes all the data that we have to a log file. What do we want to have more? Namely, the first one is fine. We want to start with a fixation dot. But it's good to rename it to fixation, I think, so we know that this sketch pad shows a fixation. After the fixation dot, yeah, you need power probably on.
Yeah.
Are more of you guys running into power issues? No? You're fine? Otherwise, maybe Daniel can go get a power extension thing. No? Say so now, huh? Because if you run out of power, well, then it can only go.
Go fetch.
Yeah. So after the fixation dot, we're going to make things are going to get interesting. We're going to add an inline script, so the little Python thing. And this inline script, I'll just call it RSVP. RSVP is one of those words that psychologists sometimes use as though everyone knows what it is. RSVP stands for Rapid Serial Visual Presentation, and this is just a sequence of letters. So when people talk about an RSVP stream, they just generally mean that they present a lot of letters or images in rapid succession. So this script, which is empty now, is where we're going to define our stream of letters, right? And then we're going to ask for two responses, because we need to ask the white letter, and we need to ask for the x. So we're going to drag, and we need to, so we drag it. I'll just do it and then I'll explain. Trial sequence. Yes. Okay. Ask. T1.
Response.
T1. Ask. T2. And response. T2. Okay. So what's going on here? We start with a fixation dot, which is easy. Then we have our RSVP stream, we have the rapid stream of letters, which includes our white letter and our x. Then we ask the participant to report the T1s, the white letter. And then we collect the participant's response to the T1. Then we ask the participant to report T2, the X, right, which was either present or not. And we record the participant's response to the T2. And then we log all the data to the file. So that's basically what we're doing. Which is fine. But what's wrong with this, what's wrong or what's incomplete about this trial sequence? Any idea? Is this like, is this?
There is no response for T1.
I think you mean the right thing, but what could you clarify a little bit?
Because I didn't see another item for T1 response.
Well, we have here we have the ask T1 thing, it's like a screen that says to the participants what was the white letter. And then the thing that is called response T1 is for collecting the response of the participant to that, right? But what is wrong with that?
Well, in our control condition, we do not want to ask if there was a white letter.
Exactly. So we always want to ask the participant about T2, but only in the experimental condition do we want to ask the participant about the T1. So how are we going to fix this trial sequence? Exactly, run if condition is? Exactly. So we go to here. Okay. Condition is experiment. Oh. Condition. Oh wait, experimental, I think. Or did I call it experiment or experiment? Experimental. So that's one of these sneaky things, right? If I would misspell it, if I would say condition is experiment because I misremembered, then we would never ask the participant for T1. So making sure that you don't make any spelling mistakes is kind of important. Yeah, so that's fine in principle. So this is the structure, this is the flow of our trials. Does everyone understand what's going on here? Is this kind of clear? More or less? Yeah? Good. So, now things are going to get really, really complicated. Because we are going to create our RSVP stream. Now, this is going to be tough, but I think we can manage. Yes. Because this is going to be a lot of Python code. Now, before we do that, let's just briefly quick click on fixation. You see the fixation right now has a duration of 0, which does not necessarily mean that the fixation result is not shown at all, but it means that it is shown, and then the experiment moves on right away to the RSVP script, which is probably not what we want. So let's say that we want to show that we changed the duration to 1,000, which means that the fixation result is shown for 1,000 milliseconds, or 1 second. Right? So it seems like a sensible duration for a fixation rate. Maybe a bit more. Anyway, 0 is not a sensible duration. So that's easy. And then we click on RSVP. Okay. Now, I will try to be as clear as possible. I think if you have never done anything in Python, this will look a little bit magical, but please interrupt me if it's not clear. So, to begin with the basics, OpenSesame, if you look at this script, you see that there are two things, two tabs here. One of them is called prepare, and one of them is called run, and they're both empty. Now, does anyone have an idea about what the difference between these two tabs is, like the difference in the script is? No. The difference is the following. We want the problem, basically, that OpenSesame has, is that we want to be as efficient as possible when we show our stimuli, right? Say that you have like a very complicated display, and it takes a little bit of time to create that display. So if we do that during the trial sequence, then we will have all kinds of delays in our trial sequence that we don't want, right? That's a problem. So what OpenSesame does is in the, whenever it executes a trial sequence, it first tells all these items in it to prepare. It says, okay, fixation dot, prepare yourself. Draw a fixation dot. But don't show it, just draw it and remember. Etc. And here too, here too. All these items get a chance to prepare so that they are as efficient as possible when they are actually executed. Now, when I click the tab here that is labeled prepare, is executed when this item is given a chance to prepare. And the tab called run is executed when the actual stimuli should be shown, basically. Right? So the idea is that in the prepare tab, you put all the preparatory stuff, like you prepare your stimuli, you prepare your sounds, you do whatever you want to do, but you don't actually show anything on the screen, and you don't actually play anything, any audio or whatever. And then in the run phase, you only show the things that you previously prepared, and you only play back the sounds, for example, that you have previously prepared. That's kind of the logic. And the idea is if you do that well, then your experiment will have very good timing. That's kind of the logic. So basically, usually, or in many cases, a lot of the stuff will actually be in the prepare phase, because you will want to do as much as you can during the preparation and as little as you can during the actual execution of the experiment. Now, so we're going to start in the prepare phase, right? So I've activated this prepare tab. Then the first thing we're going to do is import random, import string. I cannot, unfortunately, in this time give you an entire explanation of how Python works. But just to make sure that you kind of understand what is going on, import means that you kind of include some functionality in your experiment that you're going to use later on. So Python has a library that is called random, and if you want that and the random and that library allows you to draw random numbers, etc., make random selections. If you want to use that module in your code, you have to import it by saying import random. And string is also a module that has some kind of string things in it, right? Some text things in it that you also have to import. So we import these two things because we're going to use them later on. Now, then what we're going to do is we're going to start by specifying the color of the T1. So, does the color of the T1 vary? Is that something complicated? Or is it always the same? The T1 is the white letter. It's always white. Right, so we just say T1 color is white. By the way, in Python you can use these kinds of double quotes and single quotes interchangeably. Makes no difference. So the T1 color is white. So we are just going to first define some properties of our stimuli, right? So one property is that T1 is white. Another property is that our letters, the duration of the letters, is only 10 milliseconds. Which is very short because it is a rapid serial visual presentation, right? And then we're going to specify that ISI is 17. What this means, what we want this to be, is that we present the letter for 10 milliseconds, then we blank the screen for 70 milliseconds, then we present the next letter, and so on, and so on. One thing to note is that, like, say that you have this, I say, well, the duration of the letter is 10 milliseconds, but say that you have a 60 hertz monitor, most monitors are 60 hertz, so they refresh 60 times per second. Can you then present something for 10 milliseconds? Is that logically possible? That's a difficult question. Yeah. So let's just calculate this. Okay. Here it is. So if you have a monitor that refreshes 60 times per second, then every frame, so the frame duration of that monitor, is 1,000 milliseconds divided by 60. And that is 16.666 milliseconds. You understand that? So if 16 times per second you present a new display, then each frame, each display lasts 16 milliseconds. Does that make sense? So that means that stimuli are always presented a multiple of 16 milliseconds. You cannot present something for 10 milliseconds. If the monitor refreshed 100 times per second, you could, right? Because 1,000 divided by 100 would be 10. But most monitors have a refresh rate of 60 Hz, which means that you can just, the limitation of your hardware is that the duration of stimuli must always be a multiple of 16.666666666 milliseconds. That's just a limitation of your monitor. If you then present an impossible duration, like 10 milliseconds, what will happen is that it will actually be rounded up. So the letter duration will be rounded up to 16.667 milliseconds, and the ISI, which is now 70, will be rounded up to, I actually don't know what the nearest thing is. I think 3 times 16 will be 4 times, no, wait. So will be, the 70 will be rounded up to 8. 8 is something, right? So that's always something important, something that important to keep in mind if you specify like super short durations, that the durations have to be physically possible, right? You cannot on a 60 Hz monitor present something for 10 milliseconds. That's just not possible. Okay. All right, so those are the things that are fixed. We have a fixed color for the T1, white. We have a fixed letter duration, 10, rounded up to 16, and we have a fixed interstimulus interval, right? ISI is what psychologists usually use for interstimulus interval. So the interval between one letter and another. 70, rounded up to 8. Okay, then things are going to get a bit more complicated. The position, we're going to define the position of the T1. I'll just type it and then I'll explain it. Okay. What does this mean? Well, we're going to define T1 DOS, which is the variable that is going to specify the position of the T1, right? So whether it's going to be the first letter or the second one, the fourth one, etc. The position of the T1 is going to be randomly selected between 7 and 15. And why? Well, because that's the way they did it in the original experiment. So 7 would mean that there were 7 letters before the T1, and 15 would mean that there are 15 letters before the T1. So the position of the T1 in the string is random, but it is random between 7 and 15. Okay. Do you kind of understand what we're doing here? It's complicated, no? This is complicated. An attentional blink experiment is one of the more complicated experiments that you can create. But you guys wanted it last week. I remind you. Then we're going to indicate the max lag. What this means, the max lag, is the number of letters that follow the T1. And this was fixed. Why? Because they did it like that in the original experiment. So after the T1, after the white letter, there were always 8 other letters. Okay. So, how long is our stream of letters? So how many letters do we have? Well, we have position of the T1 plus the maximum max lag, so the number of letters that follow T1, plus 1 for the T1 itself. Okay. Right? So say that T1 happens to be 10, T1 also happens to be 10, then the number of letters in our stream is 10 plus 8 is 18 plus 1 is 19, right? So we will present 19 letters. Okay, that's nice. Okay. now we have to decide. Now we kind of decided how many stimuli we have, where the T1 is going to be, etc. But we have not decided what the actual stimuli are going to be, right? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to make use of the fact that Python in this string module has a list of all letters in the alphabet. You can see, I will explain it here. If I say import string, string dot ASCII uppercase, you will see that it returns all letters in the alphabet, right? A, B, C, E, G, F. Now, which is fine. What we're going to do is our list of stimuli. Stimlist is random.sample. I'll type it and then I'll explain it. Letters. Wait, letters is string. ASCII uppercase. Letters for dot string then. Okay, so what does this mean? Well, the letters that we're going to sample from are just all uppercase letters in the alphabet, the ones that you see here. Then from all of these letters, we're going to randomly sample it using the random.sample function. From these letters, the number of letters specified by string. So for example, we're going to randomly sample 19 letters out of this alphabet. And that is going to be our list of stimuli. Okay, so that is fine in principle. But, and this is an advanced question. What is wrong with the way we are randomly sampling our letters? Yes, you're both kind of right. You're a little bit more right or more complete. Because indeed, it includes the x. So there's a possibility that we will randomly sample an x, because the x is part of all uppercase letters, in the control condition. Not in the control condition. If the T2 is absent. Right? In some trials there is no T2, so there's no x. But then we can still, by chance, accidentally sample an x in our descriptors. We don't want that. So we're going to manually remove the x from here. And we're going to do it like this. Let's say. Now, so what are we doing? We take all these letters, all the uppercase letters, and we turn it into a list. If I do this, also here. So basically, string.ascii uppercase is a string of all letters, so it is a sequence of characters. If you turn it into a list, it will suddenly become a list of individual characters. Are you guys familiar with the concept of a list in programming languages? Sometimes it's called an array, or a list, or a matrix, or a vector. Okay. Je pense que tu n'as pas importé string ici, c'est ça? Donc, ASCII uppercase is part of the string module, and if you want to use it, you have to import string first. So it is not always available, it's only available after you've imported string. So what we're doing here, we're making a list. What Python calls a list and what other programming languages call an array, or a vector, or whatever. A list of letters, and we remove the x from that list so that we don't accidentally sample the x, which we don't want. And then we randomly sample from the stream of letters the number of letters that we want. Okay. Alright, so this is pretty complicated stuff, guys. I mean, if you make an experiment like this by yourself, I think it should be fair. But together we can do it. And the important thing, I guess, and if you don't, the important thing for you guys is now not to understand everything that Python all the Python syntax and stuff, all the Python specific things, which are, but the important stuff, important things that you understand, kind of the logic of what we're doing step by step, so that you kind of conceptually understand what we're doing. That's the important thing. Okay, now, so this is pretty good. This is pretty good. But we want to do something special if var.t2 present is yes. Now, all right. I'll just type it and then I'll explain it again. Var.t2 plus is specified a few things here, right? T1 color, letter duration, etc. But we've not specified T2 present. So where does that variable come from? Do you guys remember? Where did we define T2 present? In the block loop, exactly. So here in the block loop, we define T2 present in lag. And here in the script, these variables will be available as var.lag and var.t2 present. So var.t2 present and var.lag here have been defined in this block. Okay, so basically if t2 present is yes, is y, right? Yes, y stands for yes. Then what we're going to do is determine the t2 pulse and set the statement state. Can anyone kind of explain what this little piece of code does? Well, I just kind of explained it, but can you explain it in a little bit more detail, what exactly the logic is here? What are we doing here? So, var.t2 was?
You're specifying the position of t2.
Exactly.
So after ty, and we arrive by lag, so from the between 7 and 15.
The lag was
between the 0 and 10.
Exactly. Yeah, you're right. So the t1 position was varied between 7 and 15. Oh, you're right. Exactly. That's what we're doing here. So the t2 position, the position of the x, if the x is present, depends on the position of the t1, the white letter, plus the lag, the distance between the white letter and the x. And that's what we're specifying here. So position of the t1 plus the distance between the t1 and the t2 determines the position of the t2. Then what are we doing here? It's kind of complicated Python syntax, but I think you don't need to know Python to kind of understand what we're doing here.
That's this sinus, which is t2, is always sinus.
It is always x. So what we're doing is we have a list of stimuli. And at the position, so between these square brackets, at the position of the t2, we add an x. That's what we're doing. All right. Yes. Perfect. Okay. So. All right. I've seen something that's a little bit odd, I think, about this experiment. Daniel, you've done attentional blink experiments, right?
In E prime.
It seems that the way I made this experiment, the T1 and the T2 can be the same thing. So there can be a white X. Is that normal? Is that like a normal property of an attentional blink experiment, or did I just make that up?
I'm not sure, but I would say that's normal. That is possible.
It is possible.
Because you have to report two things at the end as well, right? So you can also report the same thing.
Yes, okay.
It might be a bit of a contamination or just like something okay. that's undesirable, but the chance that it happens is so small.
Well, it happens in one place when the lag is zero, right?
So yeah, that's when you have two letters that
Yeah,
so that's already you have to have that like zero, and you have one of 26 yeah. chance that yeah,
so
it is.
I when I explained it initially, I assumed that the like zero would mean that the T2, so the X comes immediately after the after the white letter. But the like zero actually means that the X is white. So the T2 and the T1 are the same letter. That can happen. In at least in my variation of the intentional letter. Okay. All right, so this is fine. So now we essentially have defined our list of stimuli. What we need to do now is make a list of canvas objects to show these stimuli, right? So now what we have here is just a Python object that is a list of letters. And we cannot just show these lists of letters on the screen. If you want to show it, we need to create what are called canvas objects, which are like visual things that have these letters on them. And it goes as follows. Right, I will just again type it and then create comments objects. If you put the square, like if you put this hashtag before something, it means that it's a comment. Okay, type it and then explain. Letter comments list. This is a lot of code. So, but I'll walk you through it, so you understand the logic of what we're doing. So, we start, we're going to create a list of canvas objects, and a canvas object is one display. So the list of these canvas objects is a list of displays, right, which I present one after another. And we're going to start with an empty list. And if you just, in Python, you put these two square brackets, it means that you have an empty list. Like it's a list with nothing in it. And we call it letter canvas list, right? So we start with an empty list called letter canvas list. Then what we're going to do is we're going to loop through all our stimuli which we have previously defined. Right, so we have this stim list, which is a list of all the letters, right? So it might be T, Y, T, blah, 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 blah. It's just a list of all letters. And we're going to loop through it. If you use this construction for I, comma, stim in your word stim list, what it will do is it will keep track of the position of the letter, is I, and the letter itself. So the first time that we run this code here below, I will be zero. Stim one, for example, be A. The second one, I will be one. Second time, I will be one. And stim might, for example, be C, etc. Who of you is familiar with the concept of for loops in whatever programming language? Have you ever worked with for loops? No? I will just show you a very simple for loop so you can understand what's going on. If I say this, I'll type it in this little terminal here. This little terminal is kind of like a playground, right? You can type some stuff in it. If I say for I in 0, 1, 2, print I, and I will execute this. You can see the concept of a for loop. We have a list with the values 0, 1, and 2, and we loop through it, and we print them out. So the first time, I will be 0, and we print it out. Print out 0. The second time, I will be 1, we print it out, you will see 1. The third time, I will be 2, we print it out, and you will see 2. Right? So that is the concept of a for loop. You just, you have something, you have some list that you can loop through, and then you execute some code for every item in that list. That's the idea of a for loop. And you have that concept for loops exist in every programming language. So here we have a for loop, a slightly more complicated for loop that walks through all the stimuli in our stimulus list. Okay, now.
Maybe explain what enumerate does as well.
Yeah, good point. Okay. Let's give another example. For I call a letter in enumerate. A, B, B, or C. Print. Here you see what enumerate does. We have a list, this time a list of letters, A, B, and C. And instead of looping directly through this list, like we did before, we call enumerate. And then what we get is the position of the letter and the letter itself. And if we print them out, you will see at position 0, there will be an A. Position 1, there is a B. At position 2, there is a C. And that's the idea of enumerate, right? So you loop not only through the contents of the list, through the letters that are in the list, but for every letter in the list, you also get the position of that. That's what the enumerate does. Very, very convenient, a little bit complicated. So here we use enumerate to loop through all our stimuli in the list, and at the same time, remember what position you're in. Okay. Then here, what we're doing is we create an empty canvas, which we call letter canvas. So it's just going to be an empty display. And we're going to draw on that empty display. So it's like a sketchpad. Canvas is like a sketchpad, but it's a sketchpad in Python. Then, if I is var1 tuples, we change the foreground. Okay, what's happening here? If we are at the position of the T1, so if the position of the letter corresponds to the position of the T1, we're going to change the foreground color to the T1 color. In other words, in normal language, for the T1, we're going to make it white, right? Because the T1 should be white. And if the position does not correspond to the T1, we're not going to do that, and we're going to use the default foreground color, which is black. Which should be black, actually. We're going to check whether it actually is black. Then, we're going to draw text on the letter canvas. So we're going to draw a letter on the canvas. And which letter? Well, a letter specified by stim. So, and then we're going to remember put this letter canvas, which is just a simple, which only has one single letter on it, and we're going to add it, append it to the list of canvases. Okay, so this is a lot to take in, maybe. So let's go over it one more time. We start by creating an empty list of canvas objects, which initially has nothing in it. Then we're going to loop through all our stimuli, which are just letters, our stimuli are letters. We remember for each stimulus the position of that stimulus, right? So like 0, A, for example. Then for that position and that stimulus, we create an empty canvas. We check if the position is the position T1, in which case we change the foreground color to the T1 color. right? Because we want the T1 to be white and not have the default grid. Then we draw the stimulus, the letter, to the compass. And the compass is added to the list of compass objects. Okay, this is by far the most complicated part of the tutorial. Do you guys understand what is going on here conceptually? Or are you completely lost?
Well, the last two lines I don't understand.
These two.
Right.
Okay, maybe the naming is a little bit, let's just call this list L. Then it becomes a little bit clearer. We have a list, which we call L. And to that list, dot append, means we add to that list the compass that we just created. Right? And that compass that we just created is just a compass with a single letter on it. Does that make sense? Do you kind of understand what's going on here?
Yes.
So the end product, what we want to have, is that L will be a list of all compass objects. Every compass object corresponds to one letter in our RSVP stream. So we will have one compass with, for example, an A, a black A, one compass with, say, a black C, one compass with a white T, for example, if that's a T1, etc. That's what we want.
Compass is basically letters.
Every compass is a single letter, every single display.
Did you
actually
define the somewhere what T1 is, because we define the color of T1,
that's a good
one. What T2 is, but where did we define what T1 is?
Exactly, where did we define what T1 is? Well, essentially, the identity of T1 is random. So we have randomly selected a whole bunch of letters. And whichever letter happens to be at the position of T1 will be white and will be the T1. And we will actually, to answer your question, which is a good question, let's do that here. I think it's maybe a better place. Bar.t1 is stimulus bar.t1 plus. So what happens here? Well, we don't explicitly define the identity of the T1. We could, but we don't. Instead, what we're doing is we're just going to look in the list of the stimuli and get the stimulus that happens to be at the T1 position, and that is our T1. But it can be anything, it's random. We don't know what it is, it's a random letter. But that's fine. It can be any letter of the alphabet. Okay. Yes. What was a good question? Now, then we need to create one more canvas, because now we have created a canvas, so a display for every letter that we're going to show. But we're still missing one canvas. Does anyone have any idea what canvas we're missing? It's a pretty trivial one. So are the letters presented immediately after another? Is it like, okay, we present an A for 100 milliseconds and then a B for 100 milliseconds? There's a blank canvas, right? There's a blank canvas. Because we're going to show a letter, then show a blank canvas, and show another letter, show a blank canvas, etc. Blank canvas is canvas. That's all that we need to do. We create a canvas object, and that's it, because it's got to be blank, so we don't need to do anything. All right, and our preparation is done. Okay, wow. Okay. Let's go over it one more time, huh? Because it's pretty hard. We start at the top by just setting some experimental variables that are fixed. Namely the color of our T1, which is always white, the duration of the letters, or the stimuli, which is 10 minutes, rounded up to 16 on the 60 Hertz monitor. The interstimulus interval, the ISI, so the duration of the blank display between the letters. 70 milliseconds, rounded up to 80 on the 60 Hertz monitor. Okay, easy. Then we randomly choose the position of the T1, which varies between 7 and 15. We specify the maximum lag, so the maximum number of stimuli that follow the T1, which is 8. Why these values? Well, because they happen to be like that in the original experiment. Not because there's anything magic about it. Then we determine how long the stream is, based on the position of the T1 and the maximum number of items that we have. Maximum number of stimuli, based on the position of the T1 and the sum number of stimuli that follow the T1. Okay. So there we, that's good. We have defined basically the length, etc., and positions. Then we're going to get all uppercase letters, and we remove the x so that we end up with a list of all uppercase letters, but not the x. Because the x should not be accidentally gone. Then from this list of all random uppercase letters except the x, we randomly sample the number of letters that we need, defined by stream length, and we save that in a list of stimuli called stimulus. Then we look in the stimulus which letter happens to be at the position of the T1, and we remember that letter as T1 because that is our T1, right? It might be any letter, we don't know that, it might be A, might be a B, whatever, but we need to know which letter it is.
But so if you're
interrupting,
but which means now T1 cannot be an X, because it's going back to the list where we remove X, right?
That is very good. You just spotted the bug in the script. Yes. Because what could happen, to clarify, say that the x is actually at the position of the T1, so we have a lag 0. And what happens here is that I set the T1, I read the T1, but then I actually override it here. I replace it by x, so that is a bug. Shouldn't be like that. It was not actually like that in the tutorial. I just accidentally swapped it around. So now it works again, right? So basically, okay, we have a list of stimuli which we randomly selected from all uppercase letters except the x. If the T2 is present, so if there should be an x, we determine where the x should be shown, T2 position, based on the position of the T1 and the lag. And then at that position in our list of stimuli, we add an x. So this x replaces whatever left letter happened to be there before. At T2 position, it will be fixed. And then, from our list of stimuli, we look at which letter happens to be at the position of T1, and we remember that as the variable T1. If I explain it like this in like normal English, then can you kind of follow what is happening? Okay, and then, what we're going to do after that, we're going to create canvas objects for all these stimuli. So we start with an empty list, L, of canvas objects, and we're going to loop through all our stimuli, all our letters. And we remember for every stimulus the position of that stimulus in the list. So we may start with 0, A, 1, B, etc. We create an empty canvas, which we call letter canvas, and we check if the eyes or the position of the letter happens to correspond to the T1. If so, we change the foreground color to the T1 color. So that we draw, for example, the white letter, not for example, so that we draw a white letter at the position of the T1. And then we draw the text. We draw that letter as text to the canvas. We're done, the canvas is done because there's only the single letter on it. And we save that letter, we add that letter to the list of canvas objects. And then finally, we create a blank canvas object, which we're going to show during the interstimulus. Okay.
One more question. So this script is only working for the experimental condition, right? Because for the control condition where we do not have a T1, what we program is based on T1 or T2. So if there is no T1.
That is a good question. So what is the script is nevertheless correct, or at least it does not suffer from the problem that you're pointing out. Why not? What was the instruction in the control condition? No, let me rephrase. Are the stimuli actually different between the control condition or the experimental condition? Or is it just the instruction that differs?
The instruction
It is just the instruction. So in the control condition, the T1 is still shown. The participant is just not instructed to report it.
It's also shown in white?
Yes. It needs to be shown in white, because if there was no white letter in the control condition, then just maybe the effects that we would find in the experimental condition are just due to the fact that it represented the white letter. Right? So that is. Okay, guys, wow. So we made a pretty complicated script. Too complicated, maybe, I think, now for this tutorial. But we did it anyway, right? Are you kind of with me? I see some pretty blank faces. But you can look at that. Huh? We have the tutorial, you can read it. Okay, that was step 9. Mm-hmm. Yes? Okay. So, are we done with programming? Or is all the programming now done? Now that we have done we've prepared our stimuli, or do we still need to do something? What crucial ingredient of our trial is still missing? Have we actually shown anything on the screen? No. The only thing that we've done so far is create compost objects and remember them. But they are not actually shown on the screen. Right? We need to explicitly say to OpenSesame, okay, you have a compost object in memory somewhere, now show it on the screen. So that's what we're going to do in the run phase. But that's pretty easy. That's pretty easy. So I'll show it to you how it works, and then I'll explain it, but this way. For letter compost in L, because we renamed letter compost list to L to make it a little bit less ambiguous. Show. Oh, let's see. Letter blank compost in show. Oh, let's see. For item. Alright, so we have another for loop, but a more less complicated one than before. Does anyone dare to venture a guess what this script is doing? I think you can tell. Even if you don't really understand Python, I think this is almost just readable as normal English language, right? What's happening here? Exactly.
One is the blank one. And the other one is the one with the letters.
Exactly. So what is happening is we loop through all the compost objects. We have L, which is a list of compost objects, and we loop through it. So we start, for example, with the letter compost that has an A on it, right? And we say, okay, show that letter compost. We say letter compost will show, and it will be shown on the screen. Will appear on the screen. Then we say clock.sleep var.letter duration, which tells OpenSesame, okay, sleep for a specific period. That period has been defined with the var.letter duration, and we set that to 10. So sleep for 10. Then show the blank compost. Sleep for a period defined by ISI, var.ISI, which we set to 7. Then move on to the next compost and do the same thing. Show the next compost, sleep for that duration. Show the next compost, sleep for ISI. Move on. So we loop. We do this all the time for all the composts that we have prepared. So this is basically the execution of our RSVP stream. This is actually showing all those compost objects one after another. So this is manageable, right? This is quite easy to use.
Did you have any end before?
No, good question. So, in some programming languages, syntax kind of resembles something like this. Or you might have something like, as you say, and for. In Python, what determines the blocks, so what determines which code belongs together, is the indentation. So if I, for example, say here something, an output existent, OpenSesame knows that X is 10 is no longer part of this for loop because it is not indented. See what I mean? So there is no explicit end for loop. It is just the indentation of the code. And if I would, for example, say this, then suddenly the X is 10 would be part of the for loop. So, but I think that's kind of nice because it makes the code really easy to read, right? Because you kind of visually all the blocks are grouped together by the fact that they're indented in a particular way. Okay, but good question. Good question. All right. Well, guys, the difficult stuff is over, basically. And now we can go back to business as usual, working with user instances. Step 11 is to create the fixation point. We actually already did that because it is just changing the duration of the fixation bolt to a better value, which I already know. Then we're going to define the response collection.
For the fixation bolt, if you change so the size duration and then black is the default, because if I change it, it doesn't change. In your case,
what's the question? Yeah, it's white, it should actually be black, right? You're right. Yeah.
No, I'm just wondering where you, because it doesn't.
Oh,
you're entering.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So basically, if you want to, if you don't have anything selected, you will not see any options. Mm-hmm. If you click on the thing, you will see the options that are available for that element. So you will see for fixation build, it's only the color, basically. So, and that reminds me that when we changed the foreground and the background, I actually forgot to change the foreground, right? I left it on white, but it should be black. Because all letters are black by default, except the T1, which is explicitly indicated to be white. So the default foreground color should be black, not white. Okay. Now, we're going to the response collection phase. So both for the T1 and the T2, we first have a screen called Ask T1 that gives some instruction to the participant, like report T1. Then we have a response T1 object that actually collects the response, and the same for the T2. So I click on Add T1, and then I add some text. So what text would be good here? What is the question that we want to ask to the participant here? Exactly. What was the white letter? What was the white letter? Question. Right? Okay. And then we changed the duration to 0 instead of key press. Why? Well, because if we change the duration of this ask T1 to 0, it does not mean that this is only shown for 0 milliseconds, not necessarily. It means that OpenSesame moves on immediately to the next item, which is this response T1 thing. So, then click on response T1. All right. Yes. Okay, so we don't need to specify the timeout because the participant can take all the time that he or she needs, but we need to specify a correct response. Do you guys know? Do you have any idea how we can specify the correct response here for the T1? Making use of the fact that here, during the RSVP script, we set this experimental variable T1 to the identity of that. Any idea? Square brackets? Exactly. And what between the square brackets?
It's the variable you just showed.
Yes, which is just called T1. Okay, that is good, that is good. I just actually think of something. If you type on the keyboard, this will be registered in lowercase keys. So that means like it will not be majuscule, but it will be minuscule in French. What we did here actually is read from a list of lowercase letters. So I think it will always be incorrect, because if you, for example, the T1 will be variable T1 will be uppercase A, and you type the A, then it will say, okay, the lowercase A is not uppercase A. Really matters, kind of detail. Well, it kind of matters. So basically, we get the T1, and then we call the function dot lower, which is a standard function that turns any string into a lowercase. Meaning that our T1 will be a lowercase letter and not an uppercase letter. Meaning that it will correctly correspond to the keys as we enter them. All right, allowed, do we need to specify allowed responses here?
Sorry, can we go back to the script?
Of course. Yeah, this went a little quick maybe, huh?
Yeah.
So basically any, I'll just explain it in the terminal here. If you have a string, say testing, it will be a mix of lowercase and uppercase letters in this case. If I then call the function dot lower, it will turn that string into only lowercase letters. You see? So if our T1 would be an A, then if I call dot lower, it will become a lowercase A.
Does this also mean that our white letter is shown in a lowercase on the screen? Or it's just for the response afterwards that it corresponds?
It is just for the response afterwards, right? We read it from the list, and then we convert it to lowercase, but we don't actually change the list itself. But it's a bit of a hack, and it's not particularly elegant or... I just noticed that this was probably a bug in the original tutorial. Okay. So, this is fine. We don't really need to specify allowed responses, because the allowed responses can be essentially anything, right? Any possible letter could, in theory, correspond to it. So it's not the case, like for example, in a queuing paradigm where participants are only allowed to press the left and the right button. Now, okay, then we move on to ask T2. So that's the screen that instructs the participant to indicate, to report the T2. So what should we add here? What is the question here?
Was there an X?
Was there an X? Exactly. Okay. Now we change the duration from key press to zero. Not so that the display is shown only for 0 milliseconds, but so that OpenSesame immediately shows this display and then immediately moves on to the response T2. And if I then click on response T2, this is kind of a semi-advanced question. What should be in the correct response field? X? No, that's very good. So that, well, I should clarify. Say that the instruction to the participant is to press the Y key if the X was present, to say, okay, yes, I saw an X. And the N key if no X was present, to say, no, I did not see an X. Then what can we enter here? Like if we go back to the block loop, you see T2 present. How can we make use of the fact that T2 present is yes or no here in the correct response field?
We put into brackets T2 present equal 1.
Not necessarily, no. But very close. We just put between brackets T2 present. Right? Because the correct response is equal to the variable T2 present. If T2 present is Y, because yes, the T2 is present, then the correct response is the Y key. If T2 is not present, so it is no, N, then the correct response is the end. So, close. Now the participant essentially cannot respond any letter, right? Only the yes and the no. So it makes sense, I think, to limit the amount of responses to the yes and the no. Right? Otherwise you run a risk, for example, that the participant say that the T1 was an A, right? And the participant presses the A 2 times, accidentally, and then the participant would also answer A to the response of T2 by accident, right? So it's good to limit the allowed responses to only the yes or no.
Our responses are always the letters of the two from the factor.
Yeah. In this case, yeah. Well, it depends. It's just all the keys that you feel the participant should be allowed to press.
Oh, okay, so you press one keyboard. In that case, yes and no. There's also buttons that you have.
I don't think I follow the question.
Oh, sorry. Yes, I mean these responses are refers to the keyboard.
Yes.
Not
to well, they correspond, but they can mismatch in principle, but often, of course, they will match, right? So, but in this case, indeed, we only accept the yes and the no because the only two possible correct responses are the yes or no, y or n. So we only accept the y or n. But they might be might they could also.
Because I'm thinking that, for example, you can you want to locate yes and no as different keys, for example, here and here.
Yes. And oh, you could, then you would do it.
Could specify S and L.
For example, yeah. And then what you would do,
to change also there.
You could add another column, for example, column called correct response.
Yes.
Here the correct response is the same as our condition variable.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't necessarily need to be the case.
Okay.
You can also specify a different correct response. But I think in this case it makes sense to press a Y if the target is present at the end of the target score. All right. Well, we're getting there. Yes. We're almost finished. We're at step 13. What we still need to do is specify the number and the length of the loops. Now, right. This is kind of interesting. A little trick. Say that as in the original experiment, I think what we want is that a block is 36 tries. But in the practice session, we think that 36 trials is a bit long. So, and we only want nine trials. So how can we do that? That's a problem, right? Because the practice session, you see here, the practice loop has the same log loop as the experimental session. So if we change, for example, here we say, okay, repeat each cycle 2 times. Then you will see that trial sequence will be called 36 times, right? So our block loop will consist of 36 trials, but this will be the same in the experimental session and the practice session. So does anyone, and that's not what we want, because ideally we want to change the block loop, we want to have a different number of trials in the block loop for the practice session than during the experimental session. Does someone have an idea? It's kind of difficult. Does someone have an idea how we could accomplish that? How we could use the same block loop during practice and experimental phase, but nevertheless have a different block length? Again, using variables, using a clever use of variables. Right now we have you see here we have repeat set to 2, which is a fixed value. Always 2. What we can do is we can change this repeat value to a variable, essentially, and we change this variable depending on whether we're in the practice phase or the experimental phase. The only problem is that here this is a numeric thing, so we cannot put anything between square brackets here. That won't work. But what we can do is click on this select view thing And you may remember that from last week, huh, where we edited the script for a sketch panel. That's you. And then you will see below, you will see the script that corresponds to this book loop here. You will see that this script is not Python proper, right? This is a different kind of script than the Python scripting that we've been doing in during the experiment. This kind of a simplified OpenSesame. And you will see here this line, set repeat 2, which corresponds to the fact that here in this box the repeat value is set to 2. Right? If I set it to 1, you will see that it changes here to 1. Right? And if I change this to 2, you will see that it will change also here. Right? So these are these. But here I can type what I want. So what I can do is enter the value block repeat here. And what happens now is that I use the variable, the name of the variable, block repeat, between square brackets, to specify how often trials should be repeated. Now, OpenSesame does not know how to display that here, so it gives you a warning, say that repeat is defined using variables, right? So it doesn't really know what to do with that, but it will work, right? As long as the variable block repeat is available to OpenSesame, this will work. Close this, and then what we're going to do now is go to the practice loop, and we add a variable, and we call it block repeat. Okay. Now, say that we have 18 trials here, and we really want to have a block of 9 trials. How often should each trial be repeated then? And a repeat value does not need to be an integer number, right? It can be a decimal number. And it can also be smaller than 1. So how many times 18 is 9?
0.5.
Exactly. If we repeat each trial 0.5 times, we will end up with 9 trials. Obviously, you cannot repeat a trial only half a time, right? But what OpenSesame will do is it will randomly select only half these trials. So if we change that repeat value, if we set the block repeat here to 0.5, that will work just fine. In English, huh? Not comma 5, not the French decimal notation, but the English one that we taught. Okay. And similarly, in the experimental loop, if we set block repeat, and we want to have blocks of 36 trials, what do we set the block repeat to? How many times 18 is 36?
2.
So we set it to 2. So what happens now is that in the practice loop, we set the block repeat to 0.5, meaning that during the practice loop, every block will be 18 times 0.5 is 9 trials. In the experimental loop, the block repeat is set to 2, meaning that in the block loop, every trial will be 18 times 2 is 36 trials. Which is fine, that's exactly what we want. And then, we still only have 2 blocks in the 2 experimental blocks, which is not what we want. Rather, what we want is 10 blocks. And that's very simple. We just say cycles is 10. And then we say, I'll just do it, and then you can tell me what actually happens here. It's not that complicated. Okay. So how does it work? What will the progression of the blocks be now? Right? Do we vary the condition? Like, do we switch the condition after every block, or do we? What is happening here? The question is maybe the two open.
Well, then two blocks of one condition, and then change it for another condition, but randomly, so it can be also the same condition one after the other one, right?
Well, the order is set to sequential, right? So imagine that condition one is experimental, and what will happen is run an experimental block. Then we switch to condition two, which is a control block, run a control block. In other words, five blocks of one condition followed by five blocks of another condition. The order of these conditions is kind of balanced. Even participants start with experimental blocks and end with control blocks. All participants start with control blocks and end with experimental blocks. But it's not random. It is fixed, but kind of balanced. All right.
Can I just a question about the attention of the game? Is it working that subjects who are starting with the experimental condition will not print the white letter when they enter the control condition? I mean, once you're used for paying attention to the white letter.
That's a good question. Yeah, I think it's quite possible. Maybe if participants are really used to reporting processing the T1, and you suddenly give them instruction to not process the T1, that it will still do it, and it will still show experiments, so attention. I think it's quite possible. But less so, probably, in the so. That was a good point. Yeah. All right. Well, so now it is about time to test our experiment. Let's just pray that it works. I think it will work. So, to give it a test run, right, so just to remind you, so we have three ways of running our experiment here. At the top, these three play buttons. The big one is for running the experiment in full screen, which is basically what you would do if you would test a normal participant, or an abnormal participant, but if you test a participant. The run in window thing runs it in the window, but does ask for the participant number in the log file. And the orange one is a quick run that just doesn't ask you for the participant number. It will use 999, I think. And will immediately run the experiment. So if I do that, click on it. Just press any key to begin. That is this.
So the case is not subject parent.
There is. If it starts with subject number 999, by default, subject parity will be alt because 999 is an alt number. Right? Instructions report whether an X was present. We start in the control condition because we are participant 999, which is alt, which starts in the control condition. Oh, tick, 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 tick. Was there an X? Wow. That's kind of tough. Yes, I saw an X. You see, it works right away. Very nice. Obviously, we are not sure that there are no bugs in it, no? Because it's quite possible that there will be something funky in it. But at least on the surface, it seems to work and it doesn't crash, which is good. Now, if I press escape, I can pause the experiment and quit. Now let's run with participant number 0 to see if we actually start now with the experimental condition, right? 0 should start with the experimental condition. Okay, press any key to begin. Yes, now we start with the experimental condition. So we have to report the identity of the white letter and report whether an X was present. Okay. Yes, here we go. White letter. I don't know, I think it was a T maybe. Was there an X? I don't know, maybe not. Okay. So that's it, guys. The experiment works. If you want to debug the experiment, what do you think would be a good first step? I don't think we should wrap it up, we're already late. But just to ask, like, because basically this experiment is so complicated and it is so fast that the chance that there are no bugs in it is small, right? Even for me, a good programmer and an experienced methods guy, there's probably going to be bugs in it. So what would be like a good way to debug it to begin with? Yes, exactly. Well, yes. So we could, for example, on every trial, print out into the debug window which letters are shown. We could also make the experiment much more slow so that we can actually visually see what is going on, right? So that we are sure
okay, I saw 100% sure that the white letter was a T, so then you can, you know.
Is there a way like to print in comments blocks by blocks that you can see about the other of the script, for example, if you are stopped? So, for example, if you have a long script, is this possible to have like a clear information in another window about where the script is stopping, like, because of the end?
Oh yes, if it crashes, yeah.
Or it's like maybe the connection with the window of the debugage.
Well, let's make a mistake, and then you will see. Like let's say for example. Let's for example make a mistake, I say remove, which is not an actual function. If I then execute it, it will give you an error message, it will say stopped. The experiment did not finish normally for the following reason. Why? Error while executing inline script. Okay, and then you have more detailed information. It will tell you, okay, it was in the prepare phase of the RSVP script, which was in the trial sequence, which was there, which was there, which was there, which was there, so it gives you a whole hierarchy. It will give you sort of a description, more technical description of the error. And then here, it will give you actually more informative, like it says, this object has no password to remove. It's actually at line 40 of that particular script. So it will allow you to debug right there fairly well. Okay guys, well I think we should stop here because it was already quite chaotic and it was already quite long and difficult. But if you have questions, now is the time.
Can we get the script?
The script, sure. The if you